The probabilistic origin of the second law of thermodynamics and the implications in renewable energy. Rather than a desiderative and doxastic approach, the conception in the context of Bertalanffy's general theory of systems restricts us to the fundamental structure of a consistent epistemological body, additional to what has been usual, but frequently wrongly studied as an isolated and unrelated concept. So this, what is what we are going to cover, are widely studied concepts, but unrelated. Here we are going to relate those concepts. And Bertalanffy's general theory of systems make reference that when we have two elements and we join those two elements, we acquire a new property, a property that the individual elements do not have, but the property appears when we join or when we combine the two elements. First, exemplative considerations. This is vehicles are being designed for use gasoline and not automatically will function in order to use another source of energy. That is, we can find or we can discover or invent a new source of energy. Let's say that source of energy makes less expensive energy, or let's say that energy is more efficient. But because vehicles are designed to consume gasoline, we need to adapt this source of energy to what we have already built. That is, cars are already built in order to consume gasoline. So here we have an exemptative problem. That is, because we already have vehicles that function with gasoline, if we invent a new kind of energy, that energy will not function to the cars or vehicles because they are already designed for gasoline consumption. So that is an exemptative consideration. We need to arrange or discover something, but that is functional for something that we have already created. So exemptative is construction on top of what is already built. We have to recognize that solar and wind energy are diluted, intermittent, and that there is a cost associated with concentrating them. The associated cost is the process of harvest, maintenance, delivery, and storage. We're going to say more about this in a few moments. To confront the diluteness problem and the intermittency problem, we have to consider that fundamentally the objective should pursue to model the chemiosmotic gradient of Michell and Calvin cycle. The Calvin cycle is how we store energy in the chloroplast of the plant and in the mitochondria. So first, the primary physical origin of energy, that is the sun. Practically all the energy comes from the sun, including fossils. Fossils are a compacted form of plants and animals. Animals or some animals eat plants, and plants acquire energy by the light of the sun. So practically the fossils acquire energy from the sun. So the primary physical origin of all the energy is the sun. When we join a deuterium with another deuterium, that releases an incredible amount of energy. And this is a kind of fusion that releases energy. Now we can generate an energy when we have a gradient of concentration, meaning that we have different concentrations of molecules. Let's suppose this is a room. Here on the right we have molecules, here on the left we do not have molecules. And just by the simple fact of having this heterogeneity, meaning here we have and here we do not have, when a particle or a molecule is passing from here to here, that makes energy. So we can generate an energy and use that energy from an heterogeneity gradient like this one. Energy density in terms of energy per volume. So energy density that are joules per volume. Volume is cubic meters or liters or milliliters, whatever. We want to improve energy density. We want to have the maximum amount of joules per cubic meter or per liter. And this is a kind of flux, joules per liter, that is energy per volume, is a kind of flux. And all the fluxes, including energy flux, obey the Navier-Stokes equations. These are the Navier-Stokes equations. I guarantee you these are as complex as it sounds. This is the momentum of the particle in the X position, in the Y position, and in the Z position. And all the fluxes obey these equations, but this is issue of another presentation. Life is a thermodynamical condition far from the equilibrium state. This is the equilibrium state is the most stable state, and the most stable state is death. So death is the most stable state. Here in life, we are in a metastable state. Metastable meaning is a stable state, but it is not the most stable state, but in a sense it's stable, which equilibrium state is death. So when we are trying to make or produce more energy or harvest more energy, we are trying to make continuation, pursuing life, which is a metastable state. So we are trying to pursue a metastable state, which equilibrium state is death. The probabilistic origin in the field of combinatorics of the second law of thermodynamics and implications in renewable energy. So first, the question, is the second law of thermodynamics a magical law? Meaning it's a law that it has to be followed just because it has to be followed. So for this, we're going to make sense about Boltzmann equation, which is entropy equals to Boltzmann constant times the natural logarithm of the W, which is number of microstates. We're going to use the combinatory formula, which is this one, and we're going to use Pascal triangles. So we're going to oversimplify this. Let's suppose we have a room in the right. We begin with all the molecules are on the right. And in the left, we have no molecules. Each molecule is going to be represented by a coin. In the coin, instead of having to choose between heads or tail, we are going to choose between one or zero. When a coin is in zero, that is representing a molecule that is on the right side. When a coin is in one, that is representing a molecule that is on the left side. And then we can add up all the coins, the number of all the coins. Here, because all the coins are in zero, representing all molecules on the right, the total addition is zero. Here we have another example. We have five coins in zero, representing five molecules that are on the right side, and five coins which are in one, representing molecules that are on the left side. Because we have five number ones and five number zero, the total addition is five. Now, what is the probability of the total addition going up, going down, or staying equal? So let's suppose we're going to flip a coin at random. So we're going to choose a coin at random, and when we flip it, we can get a zero or we can get a one. What's the probability that after we flip that coin choose at random, we get a number that makes that the total addition goes up? If we want that the total addition goes up, we need to choose a coin that is in zero, which is, we have 7 out of 10 coins that are in zero, multiplied times the probability of that when we flip it, we obtain a one. So if a coin that is in zero becomes one, that is going to increase the addition. So 7/10 times 1/2, that is 7/20. We have a 7/20 probability of the sum increasing when we take at random a coin and we flip it. Probability of sum decreasing, that is, what's the chances of obtaining, of choosing a coin that is in one, that is 3/10, multiplied times the probability of getting a zero, that is 1/2. So 3/20 is the probability of the sum decreasing. Now, probability of sum staying the same, that is the probability of if we choose a coin that is in zero, that is 7/10. What's the probability of getting a zero again, that is times 1/2, plus the probability that if we choose a coin that is in one, which is 3/10, multiplied times the probability of getting again a one in that coin, which is 1/2. So 7/20 plus 3/20, that's equal to 10/20, which is 1/2. So here, probability of the sum staying the same is 1/2, meaning that we have 1/2 of probability of the sum changing. And if the sum is going to change, we have 7/20 probability of the sum going up and 3/20 of sum going down. So if the sum is going to change, we have more probability of the sum going up in this example. here you have some formulas. Probability of some going up is the probability of choosing a coin which is in zero. That is zero coins, only number of coins in zero divided by the total amount of coins, times the probability of getting a one, which is always 1/2. Probability of some going down is the probability of choosing a coin which is with number one, that is all the coins in one divided by the total amount of coins, times the probability of getting a zero, which is always 1/2. And probability of staying the same is probability of choosing a coin which is in zero, which is total coins in zero divided by total coins, times probability of getting a zero, which is 1/2, plus probability of choosing a coin which is in one, that is all coins in one divided by total coins, times probability of getting a one, which is always 1/2. This is just what we already saw. Here are some more examples. Now let's make difference between macro state and micro state. A macro state is the different kinds of total addition we can have with coins. This is, let's suppose we have two coins. We can have 0 and 0, which corresponds to a total addition of 0. 0 and 1, which corresponds to a total addition of 1. 1 and 0, which corresponds to a total addition of 1. And 1 and 1, which corresponds to a total addition of 2. So how many different kinds of total addition do we have? We have 0, we have 1, and we have 2. So we have 3 different kinds of total addition. That is, we have 3 different macro states. And now what are micro states? Micro states are different possible combinations in order to get a different kind of macro states. That is, here we have just one combination that gives us the macro state of 0. Just when we have 0 and 0, that makes the macro state of 0. When we have 0 and 1, that gives us a macro state of 1. But also when we have 1 and 0, that gives us the macro state, the same macro state, which is 1. So here we have 2 possibilities of getting the macro state 1. That is, we have 2 micro state, 2 combinations of getting the macro state. And we have just one combination of getting the macro state 2, which is 1 and 1. So here we have 4 microstates, which is 0 and 0, 0 and 1, 1 and 0, and 1 and 1. So again, microstates are different kinds of total addition of the coins, and microstates are different possible combinations in order to get the different kinds of macrostates. Now the formula of the combination. Here we have n amount of coins representing molecules. And let's suppose we are calculating how many combinations we can have if out of this n amount of coins, we want an amount r of coins be in one. So the formula is the number of coin factorial, which is 4 factorial in this case, divided by 2 factorial, which is r in this case, times the rest of the 4 and 2, which give us a combination of 6. So 6 microstates, which will give us this. And we are going to be utilizing this formula soon. So here is Pascal triangles. We use this when we are expanding a binomium, something like a plus b squared or a plus b or that cube and so on. Here is the same Pascal triangles, but instead of having these numbers, the coefficient like this, here are put in combination terms, but it's exactly the same. Here is the same. Now, the number of microstates corresponds to the addition of this row, depending on the amount of coins. If we have 4 coins, the total amount of microstates is going to be the addition of this row. And here is the same. Here, the binomium expanded, something like if we have a plus b all to the 4, this is the result. And when we have the exponent is meaning how many coins out of the total amount of coins are in 1 or are in 0. So this means that here we have just one combination that gives us a macrostate in which all the coins are in 0. Here we have 4 microstates that give us a combination of having the macrostate of 3 coins in 0 and 1 coin in 1. Here are 6 microstates that give us the macrostate of 2 coins in 1 and 2 coins in 0, or the other way around, 2 coins in 0, 2 coins in 1. And here we have 4 macro states that give us the macro state of having 1 coin in 0 and 3 coins in 1. And here we have 1 micro state that gives us a combination of having the macro state of all coins being in 0. So the exponents correspond to the number of to the macro state, and the total addition of the rows, correspond to micro state. So number of coins, let's suppose we have 2, number of macro states is 3. We already saw we can have an addition of 0, 1, or 2. Number of micro states, that is, we can have 0 and 0, 0 and 1, 1 and 0, or 1 and 1. That is, we have 4 micro states. This is, we can just elevate 2 to the number of coins, which is 2, and 2 because we have 2 possibilities. Times, now the most probable macro state is, the macro state that has the greater micro state, the greater combinations that make that macro state. So here, this is the row that corresponds to having 2 coins. Here we have 1, 2, and 1. These 2 corresponds to the possible combinations, possible micro state that gives us a specific macro state. The highest micro state, or let's say the highest amount of macro state, in this case 2, that is the most probable macro state. So the most probable macro state is when we have half and half of the coins in 1 and half of the coins in 0, which corresponds to 1, and we have 2 combinations, as we already saw, that give us the total addition of 1. Minimum macro state is 0, that is the minimum kind of sum is 0. Maximum macro state is when only coins are in 2, so that's 2. Probability of the most probable macro state is how many combinations do we have in order to get a 1 in a coin and a 0 in another coin, that is 2. 2 divided by total amount of micro state, which is 16, which is 4. So 2 out of 4, that is 1 half. So we have a 50% chance of getting the most probable macro state. And the probability of the least frequent macro state. The least frequent macro state is the macro state in which we have less micro state. The less macro states are this one and this one, because we have just 1 combination that gives us a macro state of having all the coins in 0, and just 1 micro state that gives us the combination of having all coins in 1. So here we have 1 out of 4 micro states that give us all coins in 0, which is the same as saying all coins in 1. So we have a 25% probability of getting the most probable, the less frequent macro state. Here it is. Now with 4, we are going to have 5 macro states because we can have an addition of 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4. The number of macro states is just 2 to the 4, which is 16. We can just add this row in order to get 16. The most probable macro state is half and half, so two coins in 4. 2 coins in 1, 2 coins in 0. The minimum macro state is 0. Maximum macro state is going to be when all the coins are in 0, in 1, which is 4. The probability of the most probable macro state is going to be probability of having the 2 coins in 1, which is 6 combinations out of 16. So that's probability, 6 out of 16 of the most probable macro state. Probability of the less frequent macro state is probability of getting all coins in 0 or all coins in 1, which is 1 combination out of 16. So here is 1 out of 16. Here it is, few. Now with 10 coins. So the formula is number of microstates is just n plus 1, so 11. Number of microstates is 2 to the n, which is in this case 1024, which we just need to add this row in this case. Number of most probable macro state is half and half, half in 1, half in 0, which make an addition of 5. Minimum macro state is 0, maximum macro state is 10, when all the coins are in 10. And here are the probabilities. So we take the most probable macro state, which is here 252. Combinations of getting the most probable macro state out of 124. That is the probability of the most probable macro state. And the probability of the less frequent macro state is 1 out of 1024. Here it is. Now, the probability when we have 6 times 10 to the 23 molecules, because we said 6 times 10 to the 23 coins. Coins are representing molecules. 6 times 10 to the 23, that is a mole. A mole corresponds to the number of Avogadro. So number of microstates is 6 times 10 to the 23 plus 1, which is practically 6 times 10 to the 23. The number of microstates is 2 to the 6 times 10 to the 23. The most probable microstate is half coins in 1, half coins in 0, which is 3 times 10 to the 23 if we add them. Minimum macrostate is going to be 0. Maximum macrostate is going to be 6 times 10 to the 23. And here we cannot calculate the probability because the probability is going to be how many combinations we have in order to get 3 times 10 to the 23 divided by all the macrostate, which is 2 to the 6 times 10 to the 23. But when we plug this in Wolfram Alpha, it is overflow, so we have not the answer here. But so this is the formula. Excuse me for these errors. They are the other way around. 4 will be here, 2 will be here. But we can see that the probability of the most probable macrostate, as we increase the number of coins, is going to decrease, is decreasing. But that is because if we're going to choose all the possible macrostate compared with specifically the most probable macrostate, obviously it's more probable of getting another macrostate that don't be the most probable macrostate because we are combining all the other macrostates. But if we ask what is the specific more probable macrostate, that is one macrostate compared with specifically another macrostate, not compared with all the other macrostates, that is, this is the most probable macrostate, even though the probability of getting specifically that macrostate is decreasing. So here we can say when we have all the coins in zero, that is when all the molecules are on the right side, we have extremely ordered. Here is very organized the molecules. When we have half of the molecules in the left and half of the molecules on the right, here we have some disorder. And this is the maximum disorder we can have. It's more disorder when we have half of the coins in zero and half of the coins in one correspond to right and left. Then when we have, let's say, 2 coins in one and 2 coins and 2 coins in zero and 8 coins in one. So the most disorganized state or macrostate is when we have half and half, and everything tends to disorganization because we already saw when we have half and half of the coins in one and in zero, that is the most probable macrostate. So everything tends to disorganization. And now we can say that the second law of thermodynamics, that is, that we always are going to have entropy, that is not a law that has to be followed just because it has to be followed. Here you already see the derivation, the mathematical derivation with the table. So now let's make sense of the equation of Boltzmann. Entropy equals to Boltzmann constant times the natural logarithm of W, which is the number of microstates. We already saw what are microstates. Now, when we have specifically 2 options, like in the coin, when we have to choose between 1 or 0, we say entropy is equal to the negative total addition of the probability of what we are expecting times the logarithm base 2 of the probability of what we are expecting. Now, why we do not need to decide whether global warming is real, nor if it is produced by human activity to pursue efficient renewable energy? First, this is, we can classify the problem in 3, which is harvesting energy. So we can try of improve the energy that we are capturing, the harvesting. We can try of improving the internal transformation, that is transforming the energy that we already harvest into, let's say, chemical energy for cars or vehicles. But what's important is the utilization, that is, we can harvest energy, we can transform energy in order to get energy for a car. But if that car is going to be used in order to transport illicit drugs, we are making harm to the society. And that same energy, it can be used for something that is good for society. We can use exactly that same energy that was used in order to pump a car that is going to sell illicit drugs. We can use that exactly same energy for transport for transporting a medical doctor from one hospital to another. So her issue is not to try to increase harvesting, not to try to improve internal transformation, because we are always going to lose some energy in the transformation because of what we already saw about entropy. The important is that don't utilize energy for things that are absurd or useless for society, like expensive clothes, chocolate, and so on, or less, do not use it for things that are harmful for society, like alcohol, like cigarettes, like illicit drugs, and so on, and to use energy for things that are good for society, like the transport of medical doctors, and so on. So we say, don't try to improve harvesting, don't try to improve internal transformation, just restrict the utilization of energy for things that are harmful for society. And in that way, we are going to have, or we are going to have more energy that we can use for things that are good for society, more than the energy that we're expecting to have by improving harvesting or improving internal transformation. So the issue is in the utilization, the allocation of the resources, not in harvesting or in transformation of energy. So here the discussion is not about the diagnosis. We say that it's a problem about global warming, but we don't know if it's true global warming or not. But that is not the issue. The issue is we're not discussing if it is true or not global warming. We're just saying if we want to not warm the world, what we can do is allocate the resources, meaning energy just for things that are good for society, and don't use energy for things that are bad for society, like drugs, illicit drugs, alcohol, cigarettes, and so on. And if we restrict all the use of energy that is going to promote these things, then we are going to not consume gasoline for those things, and we are not going to warm the world if it is the case that we are warming the world. But so here the issue is, we don't know if it is warm the world or don't, but independently of that, if we allocate the resources correctly, they were going to have an incredible benefit, that is, do not harm society. What more benefit than that we could expect? So conclusively, we have not to delay the historical moment of the next technological revolution with protectionism, subsidy, taxation, exploitation, and governmental control. Basic science and engineering to innovate rather than good intentions will be the key to renewable energy and to overcome climate changes. Thank you so much for your attention. Here is a YouTube channel of me and my sister. Here you can look more for the Boltzmann equation, for constant of Boltzmann, for the derivation of entropy, for terms of probability, combinatory, and so on.